In this class, we are going to discuss about the pages of a compiler. The compilation is a very complex process. So that's why that process is divided into a several sub-processes, where each sub-process represents a page. So the topic here is pages of a compiler. Pages of a compiler. So the compilation is implemented using various pages. Here first we have to supply source program as input to the lexical analyzer. The first page of the compilation is known as lexical analyzer. Lexical analyzer, or other name for lexical analyzer is scanner. Lexical analyzer produces a stream of tokens as the output. So stream means some collection. These tokens will be supplied as input to the next page of the compilation. The next page of compiler is syntax analysis. The other name for syntax analysis is parser. Syntax analysis produces parse tree as the output. This parse tree is given as input to the next page of the compiler. The next page of the compiler is semantic analysis or semantic analyzer. We can call it as analysis or analyzer also. It is our choice. Analysis or analyzer. Semantic analyzer produces correct parse tree as the output. This correct parse tree is given as input to the next page of the compiler. The next page of the compiler is intermediate code generator. Intermediate code generator. This intermediate code generator produces intermediate representation as the output. Intermediate representation as the output. This intermediate representation is given as input to the next page of the compiler. The next page of the compiler is code optimizer. Code optimizer produces optimized intermediate code as the output. Intermediate code as the output. This will be given as input to the last page of the compiler. The last page of the compiler is code generator. Code generator produces machine code as the output. So totally there are six pages: lexical analyzer or scanner, syntax analyzer or parser, semantic analyzer, intermediate code generator, code optimizer, and code generator. Here each page receives input from its previous page and provides output to its next page. Here we have a data structure called symbol table. Symbol table. So symbol table interacts with all the pages of the compiler. So symbol table interacts with lexical analyzer. Syntax analyzer interacts with symbol table. Semantic analyzer interacts with symbol table. Intermediate code generator interacts with symbol table. Code optimizer interacts with symbol table, as well as code generator interacts with symbol table. And here we have error handler. In order to handle the errors, this one will be useful. Error handler also interacts with all the pages. So lexical analyzer interacts with the error handler. Next, syntax analyzer interacts with. Next, error handler interacts with intermediate code generator. Next, code optimizer. Next one is code generator. So let's see the first phase. The first phase is lexical analyzer. Here, lexical analyzer reads the source program character by character and converts the corresponding characters into some meaningful sequences called as lexemes. So lexeme means a sequence of characters. A sequence of characters. So lexical analyzer reads the corresponding source program and converts them into some meaningful sequences, and they are known as lexeme. So lexeme means a sequence of characters. So let us assume that our program contains, our source program contains only one statement. A is equal to B plus C into 16. So this is our program. A is equal to B plus C into 16. So this one will be given as input to the lexical analyzer. So lexical analyzer reads the corresponding program character by character and converts them into lexemes. And here each lexeme is represented in the form of a token. A token may be a keyword or identifier or operator or a constant. So token may be a keyword or identifier or operator or constant. If you take C or C++ or Java or C sharp, if, else, for, while, likewise we have several keywords. And we know what is identifier. So identifier is nothing but name of the variable. So identifier or some variable. We know about operators, arithmetic operators, relational operators, logical, assignment, bitwise, conditional. So likewise we have several operators. And constant means a fixed value. So tokens are nothing but keywords, identifiers, operators and constants. So each lexeme is represented in the form of a token. So if you take this program, then let us write the lexemes and tokens. So lexeme, token. So lexemes are nothing but characters. So A is a lexeme. Next is equal to is a lexeme. Next character B is a lexeme. Plus is a lexeme. C is a lexeme. Star is a lexeme. 60 is a lexeme. And what is A? A is nothing but identifier. Next is equal to is nothing but assignment operator or assignment symbol. B is nothing but identifier. Plus is nothing but addition operator. Next C is nothing but identifier. Star is nothing but multiplication operator. 60 is nothing but constant. Here each token is represented in the form of a pair called, here the token contains mainly two components. The first component of the token is token name, comma. The second component of the token is attribute value. So we have to place this one in some angular brackets. So this information is stored in symbol table. So symbol table is a data structure which contains information about the token, such as what is variable name and what is its value, as well as what is the scope of the variable, whether it is local variable or global variable, where we can use that variable, as well as if we use some subroutines, that means if we use some functions, then what is the return type of the function, what is the name of the function, number of arguments we are passing, order of arguments we are passing, everything will be stored in symbol table. So it is nothing but a data structure which contains information about the identifier, that is nothing but some token. So let's take this example. Here this is our source program. Now we have to represent the source program in the form of the token. So what is the first token here? A. So what is A? It is an identifier. So within the angular brackets, this is an identifier. Identifier can be represented in ID. So ID stands for identifier, comma. What is the second component of the token? attribute value. Here for the first identifier, the attribute value is 1. So by using attribute value, we can retrieve information about the corresponding identifier. So this information will be stored in the symbol table as ID 1. So by using 1, we can retrieve information about this identifier, comma. What is the second token? Is equal to. If it is an operator, then we don't have any attribute value. So this can be represented in angular brackets as less than, is equal to, greater than. Why? Because this is an operator. So it should not have any attribute value. So what is the next one? B. So what is B? It is an identifier. So ID comma. So attribute value 1 is already taken. So the next attribute value is ID comma 2. Next one is, what is the next one? B is over. Next one is plus. So plus is an operator. So it should not have any attribute value. Plus. So next one is C. So C is an identifier. So ID comma. So 2 is already taken. So ID comma 3. So next one is asterisk. So asterisk is an operator. So it should not have any attribute value. Next one is 16. It is a constant. So there is no need to specify any attribute value. So these are the various tokens for the corresponding source program. Here this ID comma 1 can be written as ID 1 is equal to. This is equal to can be written as this is equal to. ID comma 2 can be written as ID 2 plus. This one is nothing but this plus symbol. Next, ID comma 3 can be written as ID 3. Next, this star can be written as this one. Next, 60 can be written as 60. So this is nothing but the lexical analyzer output. Lexical analyzer produces a stream of tokens as the output. So what is the first token here? ID 1. Second token is equal to. Third token, ID 2. Fourth one, plus. Fifth one, ID 3. Next one, star. Next one, 60. And these tokens will be supplied as input to the syntax analyzer. Now let's see what is syntax analyzer. So what is the output of the lexical analyzer now? What is the output here? This one. ID 1 is equal to ID 2 plus ID 3 into 60. So this is nothing but the output of the lexical analyzer. So this one will be given as input to the syntax analyzer. The other name for the syntax analyzer is parser. Syntax analyzer will check whether the corresponding syntax for this source program is correct or not. If the syntax is not correct, then error handler will report those errors to the user. Now it is the responsibility of user to correct those errors. So what is the duty of error handler? If an error may occur in syntax analyzer or syntax analyzer or lexical analyzer or semantic analyzer or intermediate code generator or code optimizer. If any error occurs during a particular phase, then error handler will report those errors to the user. So that is the task of error handler. So here the point is about syntax analyzer. If the corresponding program syntax is correct one, then it generates a parse tree for the corresponding source program. Here for constructing the parse tree, it uses operator as internal nodes. We know what is internal node. Internal node is nothing but the parent node. So it uses operator as the internal node, whereas the left hand side and right hand side arguments are nothing but variables and constants. If there are some keywords, we can specify those keywords as the arguments also. So here the point is, while constructing the symbol table, operator should be taken as internal node, and the left hand side and right hand side arguments are nothing but identifiers and constant. Here, while evaluating the corresponding expression, the operator which is having higher priority will be evaluated first, followed by lowest priority operator.
If you take this expression, we have is equal to plus and star. So we know what is equal to. It assigns a right hand side value to left hand side variable. So first, this right hand side expression should be evaluated first. So we have two operators here, plus star. Out of plus and star, star operator has higher priority. So this operation will be done first, id 3 into 60. So in id 3 into 60, this star asterisk operator is the operator. So while constructing the parse tree, this operator is taken as internal node, that is nothing but the parent node. So asterisk is nothing but parent node. And what are its children nodes? The left hand side children is id 3. The right hand side children is 60. So id 3 into 60 is calculated. Next, we have to perform addition operation on id 2 and the result of id 3, the result of id 3 into 60. So now plus is the internal node because this is an operator. So plus is the internal node. So where the left hand side argument is id 2, the right hand side argument is nothing but the multiplication result of id 3 and 60. Now we have to assign this result to the id 1. So here the internal node is equal to. So is equal to is the internal node where the left hand side argument is id 1. The right hand side argument is this result id 2 plus id 3 into 60. So this is nothing but the parse tree which is generated by the syntax analyzer. Or so here the task of syntax analyzer is it checks whether these tokens are following the language syntax rules or not. If they are not following the language syntax rules, then error handler will comes into the picture. Error handler reports those errors to the user. If the corresponding tokens are following the language syntax rules, then it will generate a parse tree. While generating the parse tree, the operator is taken as internal node, whereas the left hand side and right hand side arguments are nothing but operands. That means variables and constants, or we can also take as if there are some keywords, so they will be taken as some arguments here. Next, here while constructing the parse tree, the operator which is having higher priority will be evaluated first, followed by lower priority. So here the output of the syntax analyzer is parse tree. This parse tree is given as input to the semantic analyzer. So this parse tree is given as input to the semantic analyzer. Semantic means meaning. So the semantic analyzer will check whether the meaning of this parse tree is correct or not. For that purpose, it uses a software or a tool called type checker. So type checker will check the data types of the variables. If there is any need of type conversion, then it will perform the corresponding type. So let's take this example. A is equal to B plus C into 60. If A, B, C are integer variables, then there is no problem. The result of B plus C into 60 also produces an integer value, so that will be stored in the variable A. Let BC are floating point variables. Let BC are floating point variables. Then what about 60? Here 60 is an integer value. So what is the result of multiplying float with integer value? Now we are designing the compiler, so we have to store the result now. So if we want to store a floating point value as the result, then we need to convert 60 to 60.0. So if we convert 60 to 60.0, then it will becomes a floating point value. So float into float means float. So float plus float means float. So this floating point result is stored in the variable float. So in order to convert this one into float value, here we are using a statement called here the star is the internal node. Next id 3. Next we need to convert the integer value 60 into float. So for that purpose use a keyword or statement called
integer of 660. So integer of integer. So we are converting which value? 60 value. So integer of the 60 will converts the 60 to 60.0. So multiplication operation is performed at ID 3 and 60. The remaining part 3 is same only. So what is the next one? Plus. So plus is performed on ID 2. Next star. Next is equal to. It will be performed on ID 1 and this plus. So this is about semantic analyzer. So semantic analyzer will checks whether this one, this part 3 meaning is correct or not. If there is any need of type conversion, it will perform the type conversion with the help of a tool or software called type checker. Let's take an example. We have 5 by 2. So 5 is integer value, 2 is integer value. So integer by integer means it produces integer as the result only. So here the result is 2. Let's take one more example. 5.0 by 2.0. Here numerator is floating point value, denominator is floating point value. So float by float means float is the result. So 2.5 is the result. So what about the result of 5 by 2.0 or 5.0 by 2? So what is the result here? If you take C or C++ or Java, so some other persons are already defined those compilers. Now we have to define the compiler. So we have to provide the meaning of 5 by 2.0. So for that purpose, what we are doing is we are converting this 5 to 5.0 with the help of a statement called into to real. So this 5 will be converted to 5.0, as well as this 2 is converted to 2.0. So this is nothing but semantic analyzer. Semantic analyzer will produce the correct parse tree as the output. So this is the correct parse tree which is generated by the semantic analyzer. If there are any errors in this page, then error handler will comes into the picture and it will reports corresponding error messages to the user. So now it is the duty of user to correct those errors. Now the correct parse tree is given as input to the intermediate code generator. And intermediate code generator produces intermediate representation as the output. Let's see what is intermediate code generator. It is very easy to generate intermediate representation code, as well as it is very easy to convert intermediate representation code into machine code. So that's why we are using intermediate code generator. There are so many ways in order to represent intermediate code representation, like we have three address code representation, some Polish notation, likewise we have several notations. But the important notation for representing intermediate code is three address code. So in order to represent the intermediate code, we are using three address code. So let's see what is three address code representation. The name itself specifies the meaning. The instruction should contain three addresses. Here there are three important points on three address code. The first point here is a three address code assignment instruction should have at most one operator on the right hand side. So let it be the instruction. A three address code assignment instruction should have at most maximum of one operator on the right hand side. So we should not have more than one operator on the right hand side. And the second point here is the compiler must generate a temporary variable for storing the result. So if you perform any operation, then that result of that operation should be stored in the temporary variable. And the next point here is some instructions may contain fewer than three operands, fewer than three addresses. So we have to follow these three points while writing intermediate representation code. Now let's write the intermediate representation code. Here the first statement is, let us store the result in T1. T1 is nothing but a temporary variable. So this temporary variable is generated by the compiler. So T1 is equal to, so this is the first statement which is implemented.
So intuitive real of, or in place of real we can also write float, intuitive real of 60. So intuitive real of 60 will produce 60.0 as the output. Now let us take another temporary variable. So D1 is already over. So let us take T2. So T2 is equal to, we have to multiply ID3 with the result of T1. So D2 is equal to ID3 into T1. So this is the second intermediate code representation, or some three address code representation. And the next statement is, we have to perform addition operation. So D3 is equal to add ID2 with the result of this one. So that result is available in T2. So T3 is equal to ID2 plus this result. So this result is available in T2. So what is the next statement? We have to store this entire result in ID1. So the next statement is ID1 is equal to T3. So while writing the three address code, we need to follow three rules. The first point is, if it is an assignment instruction, and then on the right hand side we must have at most one operator, maximum of one operator. We should not have more than one operator on the right hand side. If you take first instruction, there are no operators on the right hand side. If you take second instruction, we have only one operator. If you take third instruction, on the right hand side we have only one operator. If you take last instruction, we don't have any operators on the right hand side. So the first rule is satisfied. And the second rule is, the compiler must generate a temporary variable for storing the result. So T1 is generated, T2 is generated, as well as T3 is also generated. And the third rule here is, some instructions may have fewer than three operands. Operand means some variables. So if you take the first instruction, then we have only one operand, two operands. If you take second instruction, we have three operands, T2, ID3 and T1. If you take third instruction, we have three operands. If you take fourth instruction, we have only two operands. So first instruction and second instruction, we have only two operands. Then also there is no problem. So this is about intermediate code generator. So intermediate code generator produces three address code, that is nothing but intermediate representation as the output. So this is nothing but the output of intermediate code generator. So this intermediate representation is given as input to the, so this intermediate code representation will be given as input to the code optimizer. Code optimizer optimizes the code and produces optimized intermediate code as the output. Let's see what is code optimization. In some programs, there is no need of certain statements. So those statements are eliminated by code optimizer. So the length of the program will be reduced. So with less memory, the program will be saved. So what will happen is, the CPU can execute that program in a faster manner because the program contains less number of statements. Now let us apply code optimizer on these statements. So code optimizer accepts this intermediate code as the input and it produces optimized intermediate code as the output. If you take this example, intuitive real of 60 will produce 60.0 as the output. So we can eliminate this statement with the help of 60.0. So the first statement can be written as T1 is equal to, what is T1 here? ID3 into real of 60. So this statement can be replaced with 60.0. So T1 is equal to ID3 into 60.0. And the next statement is, we have to add ID2 to the corresponding result, and that result will be assigned to ID1. So we can write as ID1 is equal to, so what we have to do? We have to add ID2 to this result, ID3 into 60.0. This ID3 into 60.0 is available in T1. So what will happen here? The intermediate code representation contains 4 lines. So we reduce those 4 lines to 2 lines with the help of code optimizer. So the, what is the first operation? T1 is equal to ID3 into 60. So this operation is performed. Next, we have to add ID2 to this result. So ID2 plus this result is available in T1. So we have to store this result in ID1. So this one will be given as input to the code generator. Code generator produces machine code by taking input from the code optimizer. So code generator accepts this optimized intermediate code and produces machine code. Here, in order to produce the machine code, it uses various. Here, in order to perform the operations, the code generator uses some assembly level language instructions like load, store, next to some add, multiplication, like that. So load means load memory into accumulator. So the content of the memory will be loaded to some register. So it may be R1 or R2 or accumulator or anything. So store means store the content of the register in memory. So what is load here? It loads the content of the memory to register. So store means it stores the contents of the register to memory. Here, in order to perform the add operation, we use either 2 address code or 3 address code. It is our choice. If we use 2 addresses, then what will happen is the contents of R1 and R2 will be added and the corresponding result will be stored in R1. So R1 acts both as source and destination. If we place 3 registers, then what will happen is R2 and R3 will be added and the result is stored in R1. Here we are performing operations on 3 addresses. So it is better to use 3 operands. So let us write the first instruction here. So first we have to load this ID3 to some register. So we need to use load instruction here. Here we are performing operations on floating point numbers. So after LD, we have to use F. F stands for we are performing operations on floating point numbers. So we have to load the content of ID3. This is nothing but some memory into some register. Let the name of the register is R2. So now this ID3 value is stored in R2. Now we have to perform multiplication operation. So mul, we are performing operations on floating point numbers. So that's why we are using F. So multiply ID3 with 60.0 and store the result in T1. So here the operation is here ID3 value is available in R2. So we can write the statement as R2 comma. So what is the first argument here? R2 comma. And what is the second argument? 60.0. Now what will happen is this R2 contains ID3 value. So ID3 into here 60.0 is a constant. In order to represent the constant, we have to use hash symbol. So this one can be written as hash of 60.0 because it is a constant. So 60.0 is multiplied with the content of R2. What is the content of R2? ID3. And the result is stored in R2. So now ID3 into 60.0 result is available in R2. And the next operation which we have to perform is addition operation. And here we are performing operations on floating point numbers. So that's why we have to use addf. And here what is the operation which we have to perform? We have to add ID2 plus ID1. So before that, we need to load ID2 into some register. So for that purpose, let us use LDF of load ID2 into some register. Let the register name is R1. So ID2 value will be loaded into R1 now. Now perform the addition operation. So add F of. So here what will happen? We have to add ID2 plus ID1. So ID2 value. So what is ID2 value? ID2 value is available in R1. Whereas this ID3 into 60 is available in R2. So perform the add operation. ID2 plus T1. So ID2, the result of ID2 is what? R1. So R1 comma R2. So what is R1 now?
R1 contains ID2. What is R2 now? What is R2? ID3 into 60.
So this one will, these two will be added and the result will be stored in R1. Now we have to store this result in the variable called ID1. So for that purpose we can use store. Store register content into memory. So STF of, so the result is available in R1. So we have to store that result in ID1. So this is about the pages of compiler. So this is nothing but lexical analyzer output. So lexical analyzer output is nothing but tokens. So tokens will be given as input to the syntax analyzer. So syntax analyzer produces parsley. So this parsley is given as input to the semantic analyzer. Semantic analyzer produces the correct parsley as the output. This correct parsley is given as input to the intermediate code representation. Intermediate code representation produces some intermediate code. This one will be given as input to the code optimizer. Code optimizer produces optimized intermediate code. It will be given as input to the core generator. Core generator produces machine code in the form of some assembly instructions. So this is